Thank you very much.
Oops. Good morning, everyone. I want to dedicate the shiur for Refuat Oad Aaron Yitzchak Ben Elis. And
can you give another name?
We've talked last week about Mishneh Torah, about the Rambam, and we started to learn about the what the Rambam has to say about Refuat Aguf, about the healing and keeping the body healthy. Before I go and continue from where we stopped last week, I want to remind you that the first ingredient in health is always the mental part. It's the crucial one, it's the most important one, and the Rambam is elaborating on this at the beginning of his in the previous chapter, before chapter 4.
We can't see you on the screen. Does that mean it went off?
I don't know, and it doesn't matter. There are three components in health. The first one is toxicity. The second one is your blood compounds, is your blood makeup, what's going on in your blood. The third one is your nerves energy. It's something that related to how your mental faculty is working, your emotions, the other side, not just the physicality. So we call it nerves energy. That's from natural hygiene term. That's what we call it, nerves energy. Or in Hebrew, it's called energia itzbit. And from what we see in clinics and working with people, that in most cases, the nerves energy, it's the primary one, or the first initial cause of most of the other diseases. So I don't want to, even though I'm continuing from last week when we talked about eating only when you're hungry and drinking only when you're thirsty, I don't want you to forget that even the Rambam and natural hygiene as well is emphasizing that the first important thing in health is your mind, is your happiness. Are you joyous? Are you happy? Are you stressed? Because what happens when you mentally not poised, then elimination stops or just get lower. And that's the whole point of diseases, because the body is always eliminating toxins. It's because we are eating, it's because we are breathing, it's because sometimes we're even consuming toxins in the first place. So the body, the role of the body, this is what we're doing in Birkat Asher Yatzar, when we're saying thank you to God for allowing us to keep the good things in the food and to eliminate the garbage or the rubbish. This is the wonders of creation. This is one of the wonders of creation. And when you are stressed, when you are sad, when you're not happy, this ability to eliminate toxins, it's getting reduced. It's damaged. It's not as good as usual. And in this stage, toxins are starting to accumulate even more. And that's how diseases might start to develop. Okay? So that's very, very important. Even before we touch food, even before we touch menus, exercise, and all the rest. So don't forget that. It's the most complicated thing to control. Yeah, this is also Avodat Amidot. But that's the core of health. The Rambam, before I go to chapter paragraph B, the Rambam discuss three parts of bruit, of the practice of medicine, and he says the first is the healthy people, the preventive medicine. Yeah. The second one is people who got sick, and they want to recover, and they're trying to get to gain their health back. That's the second part in teaching medicine. And the third part is elderly people, what we call geriatria. Yeah. What natural hygiene is claiming about elderly diseases or old people diseases is that there is no such a thing called elderly related diseases. I'm not saying the Rambam Chas v'Chalila was wrong. I'm saying that in his times, it was more in the elderly people. Today, what we're seeing is that diseases that were usually happening only in old people, they're happening in childhood. We can see all the diseases that you can think about that we used to see them in old people. Now they are manifested in kids and children, and sometimes even in babies. And we learn from that it's actually it doesn't come with the territory. It's not because you are old, you are prone to suffer from those diseases. It has nothing to do with the age. Because a lot of people, 60, 65, 70, sometimes they sit here and I tell them that and they say, oh, so I'm so happy that you say that. So I don't have to get it because I've reached that age. And I said, no, you don't have to get that. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of physicians are even saying that when you go to a physician with a certain measure of, you know, blood pressure or sugar or cholesterol or any certain condition that you might come across or something that you develop, they are very okay with it. They are very they're accepting this and they're not trying to fight it, because they're just saying, oh, it's because of your age. I've heard it more than once. And we don't reject that statement 100%. We don't accept that, because what we are saying is that if you abuse the body long enough, then most likely that it's going to manifest when you're old. But if you abuse the body severely, even before you were born, I mean, even your genes and your mother, whatever your mother did before she brought you into this life, then you're even going to start at an early age. Because once you're born, you're born perfect, unless God forbid you had a birth defect. But most people, when they get into the world, when they breathe their first breath, they're perfect. Hashem made us perfect. So if something happened to us along the way, it's because it's a man-made thing. Okay. So that's the assumption. If it's like a car. If you've seen a car that the bonnet is completely bent or the car is completely broken, you wouldn't say, what a bad car, what a bad manufacturer. Obviously, it was involved in an accident. That's a man-made thing. And this is what we're saying about health. Any condition, it can be mental health, it can be physical. Think about any, unless it's, God forbid, was an accident, which is also a man-made thing, but we are saying that everything that happens to a person is something that we caused. Either the parents, or the doctors, or the teachers, or the environment, or the water. But it is environmental, meaning it's a man-made thing. Okay? For some people, it's liberating. Depends on your character. One type of people will see it very liberating, because then they will say, okay, so the health is in my hands. I can do so much with it now. I can learn and I can educate myself and I can heal myself and cure myself. But for other people, other type of people, it's very intimidating, because they need to take responsibility. And most of the people don't like that. Most people like to get fixed. Most people like to shake off responsibility and rather let somebody else fix them. Then they don't need to change their ways and they just can keep doing what they used to do. And they don't need to blame themselves. And they involve blame and guilt, which is something that we don't even want to get into, because it has nothing to do with being unhealthy or making poor choices. It has nothing to do with blame and guilt and shame. These are traits that we, again, we were taught to believe. we weren't born with blame, guilt, and shame. It's something that the culture has made us embrace, okay? I want to give you one example that I was just, while I was making the breakfast this morning, I said that I'm just going to share it with you. Just one little thing that explains to you why there is such a, it's such a bogus statement to say there are diseases that are related to old age, right? You know, most of the people have teeth problems, they have cavities, they have fillings or crowns, and we know, I think everybody agree, before we even get to menu, which is the most popular subject, especially for ladies to ask, so what should we eat, and and I said, you know what you should eat. I mean, it's not a secret, it's not something that we need to even discuss. We know, everybody know, even kids know, that fruit and vegetables are the healthiest thing they should eat. No matter what they will eat, they have to combine fresh fruit and fresh vegetables in their diet. Okay? But when you are eating unhealthy, most of the people having tooth problems, when they get to old age, their teeth are not in good state. Even the artificial teeth, or some of them are missing, or they have achy gums. They have a lot of mouth diseases. So when they get to old age, chewing is very hard for most people. Chewing is a hard work. Chewing an apple, they can't. They have to take a knife and cut it to small pieces, or to peel it. Chewing salad is something that is very hard for people. Chewing celery, a carrot, a cucumber, and people need to just... So people avoid things if they're not aware and they're not conscientious. They avoid these things because from their perspective, it's going to be hard labor. So I'm going to stick to things that are very soft, that need very little chewing. Right? Just this one little thing can change the whole health condition of that person. Just avoiding chewing because of dental problems, it's going to create enormous of chain reaction, a huge chain reaction of so many health conditions related to the digesting system. Because he's going to be lacking nutrients, obviously. He's avoiding fresh vegetables and fresh fruit. He's probably going to gear into cooked food or things that don't need to chew, so they don't prepare the food properly. We can't eat food that we don't chew. It's going to start a big chain reaction. And obviously, it's going to start creating issues in other part of the digesting system. Because if you're skipping the first station, that's the first station. If you skip that first station, I'm not talking about nutrition, that it certainly is going to be lack nutrition. But if you skip the first station, then you reach the second station. The food will reach the second station unready, not prepared. So every station has a job. If you're not using what's going on in the first one, you actually... getting to the next station, the next point, and let's say the stomach is not able to work on your food because the first thing that needed to happen to that food didn't happen. Let's say the breakdown of starch has to happen in the mouth. You have the enzyme only in your saliva. So if, for instance, you're eating starch and you're not chewing, like let's mashed potato, for instance, which you don't chew, and you're just gobbling down to the, and a lot of old people having their food bland or mashed, fork mashed or whatever, depends on the condition. So their stomach is going to try to deal with something that it wasn't designed to, and it's just going to start creating problems. Just something to think about, what happens when you are not behaving correctly, when you're not following the rules, how things are going to deteriorate, and this can take years and decades. But then you call it elderly, you know, a lot of old people have problem with the digesting system. They take anti-acid tablets, they take, you know that, I'm sure you know, you've heard of. This is all related to not chewing, or eating the wrong food, or having bad dental, having a dental problem. And the more I observe, the more I see things, I realize why people are so locked in bad conceptions and distorted opinions about why it's so hard to be healthy. And it's because these small things that we don't pay attention to, and they become mountains when you're old. It's not because you are old, it's because of neglection of decades. It's bad choices for years and years and years and years. It's nothing to do with the age. I've seen old people who are completely healthy. And before the Rambam start talking about what we need to do, he's saying, actually it's not before, it's in the end, sorry. He's saying that if you follow my rules, I guarantee you, ani arev lachem. These are the words of the Rambam. Meaning the Rambam is actually promising us that if we do everything he said, he's guaranteeing us that we will die old and healthy without the need of a doctor. Even once. These are the words of the Rambam. And he's not talking about learning immunology. He's not talking about being 14 years studying in university medicine. He's talking, this Mishneh Torah was written for the layman, for the people in the street, for you and I, not for elite. So it's something that we can all start teaching our kids in nursery. Yeah, mm-hmm. Basic things. Right, these are the words in the Rambam. We know the Rambam was very, very accurate. He didn't write one word, one redundant word. Everything was measured and accurate. Till today, the Rambam is considered to be the greatest physicians and scientists of all times. Okay? So that was just something I wanted to share with you about elderly people with health issues. We all have parents, some of us don't, but I mean, we had parents, and most of our parents didn't die naturally. Okay? So we're not just looking at the kids, we can look at the parents and we can see how bad choices and poor choices are creating huge problems when we're old. So in Ilchot Deot, Perek Daled, after we talked about Achila V'Itamlut, paragraph Aleph, I'm just quickly going through, we said that Le'olam lo yochal adam ela kshu roev, and that a person should never eat if they're not hungry, ve'lo yishteh kshu lo tzameh, a person should never drink if they're not thirsty. I just want to emphasize that on thirst, we need to drink even if we're not thirsty nowadays, because our food is not highly water content, because our food is salty and is artificial and contains a lot of spices, and that drains our water levels down. So because you can trust your mechanisms, you can trust your hunger and your thirst mechanism, but only if you are staying in the nature rules, if you're staying in nature boundaries. Okay, it's like a person who is a drug addict, and he said, "I need morphine." A casualty that is suffering from pain and is screaming for morphine. That's the Herbert Shelton example. So the nurse rushed and gave him morphine, and he's relaxed. Did he need the morphine? Was the morphine the something he actually needed? No. The senses and the mechanism told him that this is what he was looking for. Right? The same as someone who needs to smoke, or someone who feels like he needs to have another drug that he's addicted to. So our mechanisms can be tricked. So it's not, if you want to rely on your mechanism, you need to make sure that you are working, your framework is in the boundaries of nature. Meaning no drugs, no addictive food, no cigarettes, no coffee, no all these things which apparently most of us do. I'm not trying to demoralize you. I'm just saying that's why we need to correct what the Rambam is saying, and to add that we need to drink even if we're not thirsty. Just to explain to you that the Rambam wasn't wrong. We are wrong. I mean, in the days of the Rambam, people didn't eat what we eat today. So you could have trust your thirst mechanism and your hunger mechanism. Okay, because otherwise there is no explanation for being overweight. If you're overweight, meaning that you eat when you're not hungry, and how can it happen? How can you eat if you're not hungry? It means that you can trick your mechanism, you can circumvent your mechanism, you can abuse your mechanism, right? Good. So, and the third part of that paragraph was that if you need to go to the restroom, yeah, if you need to do whatever you need to do in the restroom, you shouldn't linger for a second. Because this is the whole point. We talked about eliminating toxins. So that's the Birkat Asher Yatzar is the it's something to remind us how crucial it is that we are able to eliminate toxins. Okay, the second paragraph is. Lo yochal adam ad shetitmale kirso. One should never eat until full. You shouldn't eat until you fill your stomach. This is the Rambam. It's ridiculously silly. It's ridiculously simple. That's why when we hear that the Rambam saying, I'm guarantee that you're never going to be sick, and then we read and we see there's just simple things that we need to do, and we don't do them, right? We all eat sometimes things that are so lovely, that are so yummy, that we just fill up our stomach. Literally, it happens every Shabbos. Ela yifchot kmo revia misov'ato, meaning eating three quarters of what you're capable of eating. Yeah? So leave one quarter empty of your stomach capacity. This is what the Rambam is suggesting in order to... and there is a reason for that, because you know that your stomach is elastic. Your stomach, it's a sack. Yeah, it's elastic. It can expand and it can shrink. And if you are consistently pushing more than what it can contain, then it's going to expand, and then you will need more food in order to feel satiated, because that's one of the mechanism that sends your brain the message that you don't need more food, is when this sack is full. Okay, and we don't want to wait till it's full, because then it's too late. Okay, it's like, and also there is a reason why it needs to shrink, because it's throwing all these juices, all these digesting juices. It's throwing it over the food, so there is a chemical reaction. So we want to wrap the whole complex with those juices in order to break them down. So if it's full, then it's like, just imagine a washing machine. If you put washing machine and you fill it up with so much laundry, just fill it up completely, then the fabric will not be able to, I mean, the water and the soap will not be able to reach every single part of the fabric. Maybe you can lift them up, so...
He just does that. He's always making
Okay.
Noise.
Okay.
And he's not crying. He's just
no,
talking.
I understand. I'm just thinking about the... So, the same way as you wouldn't overload your washing machine, because you're just not going to get clean fabrics and clean clothes. That's the very same, and even worse, because it's not your clothes. You can buy a different shirt, yeah, but you can't buy a different body. And if you're doing it consistently, yeah, one meal is okay, but if you're doing it consistently, then you are getting malnourished, and this food is not going to be assimilated. You're going to ruin your stomach, yeah, you're going to expand it, and you're going to miss that balance of how much do I really need to eat, because now it's not the normal size. They say it's a fist size. Your fist is the size of your stomach, naturally. So when people say, I'm not full, or they ate a whole plate and they still feel unsatiated, then something is wrong with the mechanism. It's not that they ate too little. So So the Rambam is suggesting to eat 3/4 of our stomach capacity. He said, "Velo yishte mayim betoch hamazon." So don't drink while you eat. Have you heard this one before? Don't drink when you eat. Don't drink while you eat. Ela me'at mazug ve'bayan, just a little bit in the wine. He's talking about probably seudot or something like that. When you're drinking with your food, you are diluting. You are making your juices less powerful. Okay? What you're doing is the same way as you want to clean something, yeah? And you just, you know, you have your washing up liquid, or you want to clean your windows or to clean your floor, and you're diluting your cleaning products with a lot of water. So the power of that cleaning product, I'm not pro cleaning products, don't get me wrong, but I mean, if you take bleach and you dilute it with water, it's less powerful. Okay, actually what's going on in the stomach is acids. It's very acidic. So if you're diluting these acids with water, then you are reducing your ability to break down protein, because protein gets digested in the stomach. And then people have problem with protein molecules that runs around and they're not being broken down properly in the stomach. So we don't want to drink when we eat. He's suggesting כשיתחיל המזון להתעכל במאב, שותה מה שהוא צריך לשתות. When the food has already finished the stomach station, when the stomach is empty, you're not feeling heavy. So an hour or two, depends on what you've been eating, then you can drink a little bit after it finishes the stomach, because it's not much of a problem after it left the stomach, okay? So drinks what he needs to drink, but shouldn't ולא ירבה לשתות מים ואפילו כשיתעכל המזון. So don't drink too much, as long as the food is in your system, don't drink too much. When you should drink before the meal, when you're hungry, that's the best time to drink. Usually it's because you can make sure there's nothing in the stomach, so you're not interfering with the digesting system or the digesting juices. So most of us, when we're hungry, we just want to eat. And when we get very upset when people offer us a glass of water, we said, "I wasn't thirsty, I was actually hungry." But that's the best, safest way to know when is the best time to drink, is usually when you're hungry, because then you make sure your food was digested properly and completely. Okay, so drink, and we talked about it last week, don't gobble up a lot of fluid at one time, because the body cannot handle that. The body spends water a bit at a time. So it would prefer you to consume a bit at a time. Okay? So if you do that, if you drink too much, the body will not be able to hold it, the body will not be able to use it, and it usually will have to, the kidneys will have to work really hard in order to eliminate it, because it's useless in big amounts. There is a notion that if something is good, then more of it will probably be better. Water, everybody knows that water are great, but some people, I've heard of a lady that she was shocked that she heard that she's not drinking enough, and she knew that she was dehydrated and water are so important. So she nearly killed herself by drinking too much water. So we need to be tuned with what's going on. ולא ירבה לשתות מים ואפילו כשיתעכל המזון. Even after the food has finished the intensity, don't drink too much at a time. Yeah? Remember, the Rambam times were these times when people eating bamba and bisli and cream cakes and drinking coffee and tea and having borekas and schnitzel and knedlach and all the beautiful food that we're eating that is depriving us from water, and they're not focusing on high water contact food like fruit and vegetables. And then he's reminding us again, ולא יאכל עד שיבדוק עצמו יפה יפה שמה יהיה צריך לנקביו. And he will not eat until he will check himself carefully that he doesn't need to go to the restroom, that he doesn't need to eliminate anything before he eats. So important. Before you put something in, you make sure you are ready and clean. Like putting again in the washing machine, before taking the clothes that needs to be dried or hanged, you are shoving some more dirty clothes. Yeah, but in the stomach, it's the opposite. The food that needs to leave the body, it's the toxic food. It's not like in the washing machine that you're putting the unclean laundry over the clean one. So it's really unhealthy to do that. Okay, the next paragraph. לא יאכל אדם עד שיהלך קודם אכילה. We talked about it, I think, Jan. לא יאכל אדם עד שיהלך קודם אכילה, עד שיתחיל גופו לחום, או יעשה מלאכה או יתייגע ברגע, ביגע אחר. This is a marvelous advice, because sometimes people explain to me that they just forced to eat when they're not hungry, because they have something to do. I mean, they need to go to work, they're going into a meeting, a long meeting or something that will prevent them from eating. So they're just eating in advance, right? They're planning they have to plan it according to their schedule, because they're not having complete liberty on their schedule for that day. So the Rambam is suggesting something so we can do. He said, before you eat, walk, do something. I mean, move, get your blood flowing, get your heart pump. When you do that, you're actually creating hunger in your organs for the food. So you're actually creating artificial hunger by speeding things up. That's a marvelous advice. Doesn't cost us a penny. Yeah, you don't have to have a gym membership in order to do that. And you're making your body artificially hungry and ready to accept the food. So we can all do that. כללו של הדבר יענה גופו ויגע בכל יום בבוקר עד שיתחיל גופו לחום וישקוט מעט עד שתתיישב נפשו. Obviously the Rambam is suggesting that we do exercise in the morning. Before we start our day, it's very important. Even Dr. Shelton was talking about exercise in the morning. I know some people are, you know, working full time, so the only time they have to go and do exercise is some people, and some gyms are open 24 hours. Have you heard that? So that's just, you know, just to show you how far we can go from understanding health. You know, you go to a gym at 11 o'clock p.m., yeah, you're thinking you're doing something great because you didn't have a different time to do that. At 11 o'clock at night, you need to be horizontal. But you're presuming you're doing something great. You have a membership, you go into the gym, and you're feeling that you're doing this. So that's why we get this so much wonder around health. People are saying, oh, but he was so healthy. How did he get ill? Or, God forbid, how did he die? He was so healthy. Because we're thinking we're doing healthy things, we're buying all these products, all these vitamins, we're going to the gym in the wrong hours, we're eating the most important meal of the day when we're not hungry, we're filling our plates, and then we don't understand why we have diseases. So exercise is best in the morning. But he's recommending to do something really small, I mean a few minutes before every meal. Just something small, just go up and down the stairs, just do whatever you like to do in order to pump your heart or make your blood flow quicker, to feel a little bit, to feel warm or hot a little bit, yeah? Mm-hmm. Now, before you eat, he said, וישקוט מעד עד שתתיישב נפשו ויוכל. Don't eat, even Dr. Herbert Shelton is emphasizing this, and I talked about it in length last week, in the first, before I started the first paragraph, that the conditions under which you sit down for a meal are more important than the meal itself. And I can relate that to what the Rambam is saying in paragraph B2. It says, "Veishkot me'ad ad shetityashev nafsho ve'ochel," meaning that if you are upset, if you are overexcited, if you are ecstatic, it doesn't have to be something negative. It can be something positive. And we talked about being in a wedding, when the, you know, people in a wedding, they are very, very excited. The parents of the bride or the parents of the groom or the groom and the bride are so excited, and people are trying to force them down to eat. According to the Rambam, if a nefesh is not settled, if you're not calm, then don't eat. And this is exactly what Shelton says. Don't eat if you're not calm. Doesn't matter if it's negative or positive. The Rambam is calling it hitpa'alut, litpa'el, to get over. I don't know how to litpa'el in English. To get over, it's not too lit, I guess. It's not excited, but it's something that makes your to be overly. What's the word?
Stimulated.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you. That's something, if you are in under that state of mind, the Rambam is saying, don't eat. Shelton says the same thing. Doesn't matter if it's positive, you're in a wedding, you're in a simcha, or it's something, God forbid, bad news. And we gave that example that you're sitting down on a table, you made that wonderful meal, and you're hungry, and you're eating, and all of a sudden you're getting a phone call, and you heard something very upsetting. In a second, your hunger is vanished. It's gone. Most of us will go back to the plate and, you know, we'll play with the fork. We'll don't know what to do. Some of us will eat because habitually we're going to eat. But if you will be really tuned to what happened there, you understand that you don't want to eat. Kids will not eat. Kids are more tuned to them, to their body than adults. Adults living here, and kids are more related, especially babies, they know exactly when to stop. And if they're having a company, friends coming, they're going to finish the meal very, very quickly. They and some of them wouldn't even eat. So this is getting overstimulated or overexcited or litpa'el. The Rambam is saying to us, don't eat until you are calm. Why? There's no one there to accept the food. There's no one there. The employees are busy doing other things now, right? So if you're putting this food through this, you're shoving it through your throat, and you're excited about things, yeah, you're not calm, then everything that needs to work out in order to break down this food and digest it is not available at the moment. That's why the body is so clever and is switching off the hunger mechanism to tell us, listen, it's not a good timing, wait. So it's all related. You don't eat when you're not hungry. ואם רחץ בחמין אחר שיגע, הרי זה טוב, ואחר כך שוהה מעט ואוכל. It's great. That's what the Rambam is saying in the morning. Get up in the morning, do some exercise, stretches, and take a shower. Finish with cold water, which we ladies can't bear, especially in the UK. But the Rambam is saying that cold water makes your body as strong as iron. These are the words of the Rambam. So start with warm, but just the last few seconds, just spray yourself with as cold as you can bear. It makes your and that's related to cold compress. Yeah?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah? It stimulates the blood. So, and you feel warm afterwards. You don't need to enjoy it. Just enjoy a warm shower and then just the last few seconds. I mean, even on just, you know, let's say you have something on your toes, you have eczema, you have pain on your knees. If you, just that organ, put cold water on that organ as for, I don't know, 30 seconds, 60 seconds, as long as you can bear, you will feel amazing. I mean, this area is going to be strong as an iron for the rest of the day. Paragraph Gimel. לעולם כשיוכל אדם ישב במקומו או יתה על שמאל ולא יהלך ולא ירכב ולא ייגע ולא יזעזע גופו ולא יתעל עד שיתקל המזון שבמאב. Eat, sit down. Sit down and eat. Yeah, it's not this old annoying granny, you need to sit down. No, we really need to sit down when we eat. Yeah, don't walk around. Don't nibble, walking, driving, shopping, doing the other things, the chores around the house. When you eat, make it count as a meal. Sit down and eat. It's not just a mental good advice, because when we are nibbling all the time, we don't really, I mean, our brain getting a message that there wasn't a meal occurring here. The brain wants to see the plate, and it wants to see the plate full. So take small plates rather than big plates, and you know, so take small plates and mountain them up. But the brain gets the message. The brain is also visual. So if the brain sees the food in front of it and the plate is full, then the brain gets also the message that I had my share. So if you don't do that, and I know some of us probably, if you see, and when I'm saying these things, what I suggest is when you go home to your daily life, start looking at things, start observing yourself, like you have a camera somewhere up and you can watch yourself doing, be an observant. Look, okay, this is why it's not good, because start looking at what you're doing, start reflecting on what you're doing, and you see yourself in so many occasions that you can they are preventable. So when we nibble and we don't sit, we can eat so much and we're still gonna come back to the fridge and say, I'm hungry. But if we will put down in a plate everything we nibbled, but we weren't sitting down, you would notice that it was quite a large amount of stuff. Because the brain is also visual. It needs to see you eating. You need to feel that you ate, not just, you need to concentrate in the food. That's why it's mind and heart, it's all together, needs to be involved in something, it's to be present. When you're speaking over the phone and you're driving or you're cleaning or you, I don't know, you're doing something else, or you're watching or you're listening to an audio, I said to myself, why shouldn't I'm listening all the time to audios, all the time. I mean, my husband said to me the other day, I didn't marry earphones because he always sees me with earphones around the house when I'm not trying to engage into a conversation, when I'm doing the housework. I want to learn. That's my time. So I said to myself the other day, why wouldn't I mean, when I'm, you know, having my breakfast or my lunch, usually it's by myself. So why wouldn't I put just the audio? I mean, I would take the earphones off. I mean, some people have the radio on all day long. They don't take it off when they eat. And then I remember, because it's gonna distract me from my meal. So I switch it off so I can concentrate on the food. It's not, I mean, we take it for granted. I have this amazing mango or pomelo in front of me, but also I have an amazing rabbi speaking on the screen. So I need to divide my attention. So I switch it off so I can focus on the food, appreciate the food, and say the blessing, chew properly, enjoy it, feel satiated, be content, be tuned with when I had enough. And this is what the Rambam is saying. This is one of the interpretation why it's important to. He's not talking about the brain and visual, but I'm just looking at the Rambam as something that is like he's. I can talk about one paragraph a whole day because other teachers are just giving us the Rambam is concentrated. It's just the juice of things, but we can extract his ideas into something very, very big. לעולם, ג', לעולם יוכל אדם יושב במקומו או יתה על שמאל ולא יהלך ולא ירכב ולא יגע ולא יזעזע גופו ולא יטייל עד שיתקן. Okay, so it's not you're not walking when you're eating, yeah? These street food things, you know, we have street food when people walk around with the street food. It's not really a Jewish thing, even though in Israel it is. But I mean, in here or in other states, in other countries, you see that there's this culture of eating in the street. I think the Rambam wouldn't agree with that. Eating while you're walking, eating when you're, you know, doing your shopping. Yeah.
It's about chewing, though.
וכל המטייל אחר אכילתו או שיגע הרי זה מביא על עצמו חוליים רעים וקשים. And even after you had the meal, you shouldn't start jumping around. Don't take walks after a meal. You know, you remember when we were kids, you say it's good to take a walk. You know, have your Shabbos meal or whatever meal it was. Put your boots, take a walk. To shove the food down. That's what I said, you know. Help the food go down. The food doesn't need our help. As if we go, if we walk, then the food will be more tuned, more... it's ridiculous. The food will go down better when you rest, because all the energy will be available for digestion and not for muscles. הרי זה מביא על עצמו חולאים רעים וקשים. This thing, this walking around after a meal, this person is gonna bring upon himself great problems, great health issues and diseases. These are the words of the Rambam, okay? It's not, I mean, you can call him fanatic because some people say I'm fanatic. I don't know, so I think he's buried in Tveria. You can go and talk to him. Sheina, we'll go to sleep now, okay? We finished about how to eat. He didn't give us menu yet, that will be next, but now he's talking about Sheina. The day and the night, ayom ve'alayla, 24 hours. Dai lo la'adam, it's enough for a man to sleep a third. So 8 hours is enough. And preferably at the end of the night, towards the end of the night. כדי שיהיה מתחילת שנתו עד שתעלה השמש 8 שעות ונמצא עומד במיטתו קודם שתעלה השמש. The Rambam is suggesting that we will go to sleep at those late hours of the night and that we'll be awake a little bit before the sun rises. Okay? לא ישן אדם על פניו. Don't sleep on your stomach, yeah? And don't sleep on your back. Sleep on one of the sides. It's getting very specific here. At the beginning of the night, you sleep on the left side of the body, and at the end of the night, on the right-hand side of the body. You do that? Yeah? Fantastic. בסוף הלילה הצד ימין ולא ישן סמוך לאכילה אלא ימתין אחר אכילה כמו 3 שעות או 4 שעות ולא ישן ביום. The Rambam is not suggesting to sleep during the day unless you're ill or sick. So the Rambam is expecting us to be vigorously active throughout the day, so we don't need to sleep during the day in order to be balanced with the organs of the body. Sleep on the side, one side, the left hand side at the first part of the night and the right hand side at the second part of the night. And don't sleep straight, don't go to bed straight after a meal. Okay? Just wait about three to 4 hours. So if the Rambam is talking about finishing your last meal in the winter around 6 o'clock and in the summer around 7 o'clock. If I'm not mistaken, it's maybe 7 and 8. No, I think it's 6 and 7. So you ate at 7 o'clock or 6 o'clock. You go to bed at 10 o'clock. That's fine. Yeah. If you haven't eaten too much, things with oil, deep fried, a lot of protein and a lot of fat, then 3 hours will be okay for you to go to bed and you're not feeling bloated. And a lot of people tell me that, in Shabbos, when they're having a poor combination of food or not light meals, they find it very, very difficult to fall asleep on Shabbos evening. I mean, on Saturday, on Motzei Shabbat, or on Friday evening. So some people, they understand that it's something to do with the food and they're suffering the night. I know it happens to me. If I eat the wrong food, it happens rarely, but if I do eat the wrong food, especially before I go to bed, I don't sleep well all night long. I'm turning from each side to one side and I feel like I can't breathe and I need to open the windows and we feel, I know it's something that we haven't heard, but we actually better off sleeping when we're hungry. Sometimes it sounds cruel when, you know, kids are staying up late and said, "Mommy, I'm hungry." And we say, "No, you need to go to bed now. You shouldn't eat." "But I'm hungry." It's better for them to go to bed hungry. Because some other things needs to go to happen when you are asleep. Not digesting. Digesting is certainly not one of them. While you are asleep, there are some, the body is wearing too many hats. Not too many hats, but is doing different, completely different things at night. That's why it needs you horizontal. It needs you restful. It doesn't need to deal with the things you do during the day. During the day, you're thinking, you're active physically, emotionally, your muscles, your digesting system is working, you're breaking down food. And the night, it needs to work with all these pearls that you gave it through the day. So let's say you were collecting diamonds throughout the day. At the night, he sets them in these lovely stones. He set them in beautiful jewelry, so you can wear that jewelry. But if you don't do that during the night, if you're not resting, what's the point of collecting all these pearls and diamonds? Okay, so you need to differentiate between these two. Even Shelton is explaining that assimilation, when you assimilate the food, it happens during the night. There's no point of, and he stated it so beautifully in one of his books. He has a book about food combining, and he says you're not getting nourished from the food and the quantity you eat. You only get nourished from the amount of food that you are able to break down, digest, and assimilate. Did you understand that? Mm-hmm. Okay, it's a very powerful statement. It looks simple, sounds very simple, because people think, okay, they look at their plate and they're just imagining, they're taking it for granted that if I'm going to consume that, I'm going to have, my body is going to enjoy the benefit of what's on that plate. Not necessarily. Shelton says not necessarily. The body cannot digest whatever or assimilate whatever you shove through that throat. He has a certain amount, the only amount it can break down, digest, and assimilate, that's the only amount, or that's the only part from that food that you're going to get nourished from. Very powerful, very simple, but we don't think about these things, we don't do those things. And again, I'm reminding you, it's not costing us anything. It's not about money. To be healthy, Hashem is promising us throughout the whole Chumash, that if we follow his laws, if we'll do what he says, if we listen to what he's telling us, we will be healthy. Everything will flourish. Okay? He's not talking about being rich or being wealthy. He's just talking about following the rules. This is following rules, simple rules. You don't need to be a rocket science. You don't need to be a millionaire in order to know these things. I'm going to continue the last, another paragraph for today, and then we're going to open it for questions, okay? We are in Ma'achalim. We finished the two paragraphs about sleep. You see, the Rambam is very, very, very just touching just the basic, the rules, the principles. It's not lengthy and it's not exhaustively long with explanation. So it's a paragraph Vav. דברים המשלשלים את בני מאיים, כגון ענבים ותאנים ותותים ואגסים ואבטיחים ומאה קישואים ומאה מלפפונות, אוכל אדם אותן בתחילה קודם האכילה. The Rambam is saying, and don't catch my words, because agasim is not the agasim we have today, and avatichim and tutim is not the right, it's not exactly the right fruits, the names of the fruits are not parallel to what we used to do, but the Rambam is saying basically the things that cause our intestines to be loose, yeah, like things with a lot of water. He's talking about cucumbers, pears, melons, watermelons. These are the things, and grapes.